the way or the format in which you are going to use the information has to be the same for all your environmental data and biological data. Okay? So it's very common, it's very frequent that we need to convert from one projection system, for example, UTM, to geographic, or even in geographic, from one format to another format, from degrees, minutes, and seconds to decimal degrees. Okay? In this process, we can make mistakes. One very common error is that we don't know if we are in, if our coordinates have to be negative or positive, depending on the position. Okay. So, if we divide the world into quarters, north to the equator, coordinates are positive, and south are negative. The same as if we divide the world in west and east, taking the Greenwich meridian as the central meridian, to the left, coordinates are negative, and to the right are positive. The biggest problem is right here in Africa, that you have portions of the continent in three of the four quarters. So it's very easy to get confounded here. If you have a locality very near to the meridian or to the equator, it's very easy to get mistakes. So it's very, very important that you double check, triple check your locality. Now, how can we detect that we are making mistakes or that we have mistaken localities? The very first thing that you should do is to plot your localities on a map, to display your localities on a map. And in that way, you will see records that look weird and that probably deserve to be double-checked. You can also plot your data in environmental space and see if they have consistency. If you see outliers, you have to go back to the original record of those outliers and check if they are correct or not. Sometimes there are some other records that might seem that have an error, positional error, geographic error, but it's not given because of the point itself. For example, here, we work with rasters in this whole process of ecological mission modeling, and the representation of the features of the landscape are by cells like this, like this. Sometimes, particularly when you are working with coastline records, it's common that some records fall outside of the map. But it's not because the record is wrong, it's because the shape of the squares do not represent well the line of the coast. Yes. In these cases, it's not the record which is wrong. Sometimes, other type of error is the taxonomic error. It's when you misidentify the species you are working with. In this example, we have this monkey from Mexico, the brown colored monkey. There is another species of colored monkey in Mexico, the black one. They have a southern distribution in Mexico, but there are some areas of exclusive distribution from one species and the other. You see, this is the distribution of the two. And there is only this area of sympathy. We know for sure that the brown colored monkey and green do not live in this state of Mexico. So we know these two records are misidentified. So it's important also that when you see something strange in the data, double check the original. What do you have to do when you find errors in your data? You have to go back to the original record. If it's a museum specimen, make all your effort to go back, if you can, if it's possible, to review that specimen to see if all the information is correct. If definitely you find a record that you cannot correct, it's much better to eliminate those records, those erroneous records or highly dubious records, than including them and using the model. Because this type of errors can produce unusual results in the model. When you have this other situation that you have records of the map in the ocean, for example, here, but we know that the position is right. For the purpose of the modeling, it is valid to relocate these points to the nearest pixel. It's kind of cheating because we are altering the original and correct position of the point. But because of the nature of this raster, we are certain that this point belongs to these conditions in the map. So under such conditions, it's valid to relocate points. There are some other facts about our biodiversity database that doesn't necessarily mean that they have errors. There are some other biases, as which are pointed out. There are some collecting or sampling biases like this one. This is the non-distribution of the line. And if you see this data set, you can see that you have an aggregation of points here. And this type of things can affect heavily our beach model. So when you face this kind of problems, it is better to remove some points in order to disaggregate these areas and have a more even distribution of the points in the geography and also in the environmental space. The frequent procedure here is that you use mesh like this, a grid like this, and you select one or two points within each one of the grid cells and you remove the rest in order to have a more balanced sample approach. If you see the original data here, there are two types of biases. One is disaggregation, and also there is a lack of information in large portions of the distribution. This lack of information also has an effect on the models that we produce. So in this case, you have to do all the best effort to get more location for the species. In some cases, there is no more information for the species. So we need to work with what we have. So at the end of the cleaning process, you will have something more suitable for working in the rich model. So these are the steps that you need to follow for cleaning up your biodiversity data. First, when possible, go back to the original record and try to detect where the error is. Possible to correct it. if it's not possible to correct the error or to identify the error, eliminate those records from the database and reduce it to the model. Sometimes you see a strange record that you are tempted to eliminate because it looks like an outlier. This could be a truly valid record that gives us interesting information about our species. It also could happen what someone there mentioned, that we are including zinc populations in our modeling. It's very difficult to detect that kind of things. One way to do that is to plot the information in the environmental space to see if they are outliers or not. But even if they are outliers, you are not sure if they are source of zinc populations, or you are simply having a misrepresentation of the niche. It is allowed to relocate valid occurrences only for short distances when it's a problem of the environmental layers. And this is something important. Yeah, now in the practice of what we are doing for developing our niche models, remove duplicate records. It is very common that in the same sampling site, you have more than one specimen collected in that site. For our purposes here in this workshop or for exercises in ecological niche modeling, we are working with localities, not with number of specimens in each locality. So it's much better always that you, beforehand, clean up your database and just keep the unique locality records. Some programs and software, the ones that we will be using here, like Maxim and Open Modeler, have the option that you check from box saying that automatically remove the duplicate records. But it's more convenient that you do that process by hand, in order that in that way you will know exactly how many localities you have for modeling. Otherwise, you won't know exactly how many you have. And it's important to know how many localities do you have for the process of calibration and modeling. Okay. Finally, there is almost an error in our database, which is represented by E. So E refers to the error containing the occurrence data that can have a negative effect on our modeling process. And this can be expressed as omission error in our modeling process. Omission error refers to those records that are not predicted in the validation dataset after we produce an image model. So we don't want large omission errors in our model, because that would be an indication that it's not a model that is performing well. So it's important to have this estimation of how good is our dataset. The problem here is that there is not like a robust method for estimating the error beforehand. It's only a matter of how well you know and you have the control of your data. If the data was gathered by you, for example, using a GPS, and you are the expert of this species, and you cannot have a mistake in the identification of the organism, you are certain that your database is very confident, reliable, then E should be very low or even zero. There is no error in my database. the other hand, if we harvest the information from the electronic databases that come from museums or other sources that we didn't have a control on this information, it's almost certain that it has some level of error. In our experience, working with this type of information, although this is not a rule of thumb, we estimate that 10% of the records could have a problem in the georeferencing or in the identification. So we need to keep in mind this this magnitude of error. In further presentations, Tom will show you how we manipulate this information of the error in the current state. We're going to pass you these presentations. You will have a copy of these presentations. So I try to put as many information as possible in the slides for you to have. Do you have any questions on this topic of errors and